I'm at the University of Cambridge. That is the world's only working water-powered model of the British economy. And by moving this graph, we'll find out what happens when you divide by zero. For the sake of this week's Prime Minister, please don't try this at home. Huge thanks to NordVPN for sponsoring this episode. The device is known as a Bill Phillips machine, and as you might expect, it was invented by a man named Bill Phillips. He was born in New Zealand in 1914, dropped out of school to become a hydroelectric engineer, moved to Australia to become a crocodile hunter, and then spent some time during World War II working on aeroplanes. He was eventually captured as a POW, where he made tea for his fellow inmates, boiling water by dunking mains voltage directly into a bucket of water. After the war, he studied at the London School of Economics, where he noticed a striking resemblance between the fluid flow equations of hydrodynamics and the money flow equations covered in his classes. Living in a time before digital computers, he decided to simulate these equations using a custom-built water computer, constructed of old aeroplane parts. This impressed so many people that he was eventually commissioned to build another 14 machines, one of which is today housed at the University of Cambridge. This is the Phillips machine. You can think of it like a zoomed out map of the economy, where a bottle of water is worth $500 million cash, or roughly the same price as it is at Wembley Stadium. Water is pumped to the top as income. Some is taxed, going to the government. Some is saved to the banking sector, and the rest is spent. Governments pay for projects, banks invest funds, and our flows recombine. Some of this expenditure is on imports and money goes out the economy. Some extra funds trickle in from exports, and everything meets at the bottom as transaction balances. The cycle begins anew. We won't be running the foreign sector today because after Brexit, it's mostly broken. When it comes to it, the Phillips machine is a way of doing lots and lots of integration calculations using water rather than maths. This relies on a couple of key mechanisms. Now, I did ask Cambridge if I could pull apart their machine to show you these in action, but they weren't particularly pleased with it. So instead, I've built some of my own. Full disclosure, I constructed these in my bedroom, so they're not particularly leak-proof. According to the quantity theory of money, the more cash we have in an economy, represented here by water in the tank, the higher the level of income, water coming out the tank through the hole. According to the theory, the two are directly proportional. But when we try it out with water, things aren't quite so simple. To fix this, we use a special sort of hole known as a suture weir. Thin at the top, thicker at the bottom. As the height of the water changes, so does the effective area of our hole, in such a way so as to linearize the relationship between height and water flowing out. Let me introduce to you another law of economics, that of supply and demand. If we have a farmer selling eggs and people trying to buy them, then the invisible hand of the market is able to juggle the price of eggs to most optimally allocate eggs to people's stomachs and cash into the farmer's wallet. If the farmer has lots of eggs, then the price of eggs is low. Chances are if eggs being sold for $1 a dozen, then I'll be eating a lot of omelets. On the other hand, if the farmer doesn't have many eggs, then the price of eggs gets really high. I will no longer be eating omelets, but my wealthy next-door neighbour, who loves quiche, is still probably going to be buying a pack. So how does that translate to water? This is the basic mechanism. Supply is in this bucket, and then the amount of consumption, people actually buying and eating eggs, is given by the water flowing out of it. The relationship between supply and demand through the medium of price is embedded in this graph. Height of the tank is measured using a rubber duck floating at the surface. Using this string, it will then either lower or raise the board. A pin through the slot converts the up-down movement of the board to the left-right movement of a wooden bean, opening or closing a hole at the bottom of the tank. Just like the theory says, more supply of eggs means a lower price. A hole opens and people buy more eggs. The benefit of using this contraption, rather than just drilling another hole, is that we can experiment with different relationships between supply and demand. For the moment, our slot is at 60 degrees. If we want to see what happens if people are more sensitive to price, they would make it shallower. Less sensitive, steeper. When we started up the machine, I had to sand back some copper oxide residue, which had formed on this exposed wire. Originally, this would be dumping 240 volt mains electricity directly into a water stream to measure the spending flow intensity. Bill probably used something similar in his POW days to make tea, but nowadays we're a little more afraid of dying, so have stepped it down to a safer but less reliable 20 volts. As digital computers didn't exist, Bill used this contraption to convert its reading into the raising and lowering of certain slots. With a whole bunch of tinkering, Bill got his model to within 4% of the equations which, in 1950, were believed to govern the economy. As far as I can tell, no one's used it to make actual policy decisions, but governments, banks, and tons of students have messed about with its various settings to get an intuitive understanding of how the economy should work. A particularly cool demonstration was to have two Phillips machines tied together, with one representing the US and the other the UK. Even if the UK started out strong and stable, in the totally hypothetical scenario where the US does something very dumb, then both economies would fall apart. Now that we've seen how this water calculator works and what it's meant to be used for, let's do the only logical thing and see if it has a divide by zero button. Quick introduction to some relevant theory. If I give you $100 and you spend 20 of it on eggs and pocket the rest, then you have a propensity to consume of 0.2 and a propensity to save of 0.8. Marginal propensity to save is defined mathematically as the portion of each additional dollar of income that is saved rather than spent. However, if we do something sneaky and flip that round, we get change in income equals change in savings over marginal propensity to save. We actually have this propensity as a feature of the entire economy as a user-defined input, a slider like the one we made earlier. It's written here as propensity to consume, but remember, the two are basically the same thing. We start out with a normal propensity to consume graph. People are saving some money and spending the rest. Now, if we move our slider to 45 degrees, this is a propensity to consume of 100%, and importantly, a propensity to save of 0. This graph shows income. It's steady at the moment, but if I kick in a bit of investment savings, then mathematically, we have just divided something by nothing. And now? Oh yeah, it's going up. Apparently, something divided by nothing is infinity. And yeah, after a bit of time, water is spilling out of the machine. Surprisingly, this does actually have some economic validity. That $20 you spent on eggs goes to the farmer, who uses it to buy tickets to a pirate metal rock concert, who uses it to buy a hurdy-gurdy. The same cash is being used by more and more people, faster and faster, increasing income of the overall economy with every transaction. After the success of his water model, Bill Phillips keeps inventing, teaching, and chain smoking. Foreseeing the rise of digital economics in the 1960s, he helps to pioneer that field as well. At age 54, probably brought about from all that smoking, he suffers a stroke and ends up retiring, dying just a couple of years later. The Phillips machine lives on, both as a touchstone in the history of computational economics, but also for the lessons that it can still share with us, particularly when you divide by zero. Until next time, this has been James Dingley from the Atomic Frontier. Keep looking up.